the Bane Free Radio Hour.
On the podcast, Mother of Demons and Mollusk Warfare Techniques. It's a hardcover rain gonna fall. And the latest entry in our complete audiobook serialization of Larry Correa's Hard Magic. All right now. Welcome to the Bane Free Radio Hour podcast. It's an honor to have you along. I'm Bane editor Tony Daniel. We talk with Eric Flint this time about the new Bane leather-bound signed edition of his novel, his first novel, Mother of Demons. Eric gives us some insight into where the book comes from and discusses his early days as a Bane author. As always, it's Eric Flint, so it's fascinating stuff. And we continue with our complete audiobook serialization of Larry Correa's Hard Magic, as read by Bronson Pinchot. First, here's the news. The new April hardcovers are set to rain down like manna from a loving sky and appear at your favorite booksellers. I should add that I'm speaking figuratively, of course, I think. New in April is Trail of Fear by Travis S. Taylor. Hey, it's been a while since we had a new Travis book, since he's been pretty busy doing his science-based television shows. But lo, here's Trail of Fear. It's a really cool high-concept book about an alien supercomputer who gets, well, some rather odd ideas about human beings when it takes some data out of context. Also out is Grantville Gazette Volume 7, with more tales of the modern-day West Virginia town of Grantville, which was thrown back in time to the 17th century in Europe and into the midst of the 30 Years' War. Eric Flint's the editor, so you know there's plenty of good stuff therein. Trail of Evil and Grantville Gazette Volume 7 can be found at the end of the Reading Rainbow that leads to your favorite bookseller's special pot of science fiction gold. Anyway, check them out. I want to welcome Eric Flint to the podcast. Hey, Eric.
Hi, how are you, Tony?
Eric Flint, back to the podcast, actually. He's been with us many times. He is the creator of the alternate history Ring of Fire series, beginning with his groundbreaking first book in the series, 1632, and continuing through many best-selling books, stories, and collaborations. With David Drake, he collaborated on the six-volume Belisarius series, and he's collaborated with a great many other writers, including David Weber, Mercedes Lackey, Katie Wentworth, Dave Freer, and Reike Spohr. Eric's latest novel, Worth Reich, is just out, by the way, and it's called Castaway Planet, which is one of the coolest titles of all ever. Eric's writing career began with the science fiction First Contact novel, sort of First Contact novel, Mother of Demons. Now, Bane is reissuing Mother of Demons in a limited leather-bound edition that is available at booksellers, but you better get it quick. So, Eric, Mother of Demons may sound like a fantasy novel from the title, but it's actually very much science fiction, and it's hard science fiction, like sociology. Well, maybe soft science fiction. Can you give us a précis, a sort of overview of the book?
Yeah. The truth is, it's kind of really alternate history. It's just I file out the serial numbers because in this instance, the alternate universe, it's a Bronze Age. What happens is modern people get cast back in the Bronze Age, but it's an alien Bronze Age. And what I did was, in the way the wreck happens, most of the survivors are children. There's only a handful of adults, so they really are kind of thrown on their own resources pretty quickly. And what I wrote the story for, it's a little hard to explain, but it's basically sort of my disquisition on how I think you have to look at human history, which I know seems kind of ponderous, but I think I successfully wove it into an action adventure novel. But what happens in the book basically is that the handful of human adults who survive are being, especially one who is an historian, are being turned to not only by the young humans, but also by this alien species they encounter, which is in a broadly staged development for guidance on what to do. And the quandary that the heroine of the story has is that she knows human history quite well and knows that starting from the very primitive level of development that the aliens have, and for that matter the human castaways, because they've lost most of their technical base, there's really no quick, simple way to produce what she thinks of as a modern, civilized, advanced society without basically wading through centuries of toil and misery and bloodshed. And for a long time, and of course, in the novel, she just finds it hard, can't bring herself to do it. The other important elements brought in the novel is that this alien species is in a Bronze Age development, but it's also right at the point in its history where the first of its version of the great universal religions has emerged about two generations earlier. So it's as if they arrived right after the founding of Buddhism. And the central religious leader plays a key role in the way things develop. So like I said, when I just picked it that way, I know it sounds kind of ponderous, but...
Well, there is a great deal of philosophical discussion in the novel, but there's lots of battles.
Yeah, there's a lot of action. I mean, it's I swiped a lot of the plot. I got a master's degree in African history, and I actually swiped the plot from what I was doing my dissertation on, which was the history of the Southern Bantu in the early 19th, late 17th, early, late 18th, early 19th centuries. Americans are completely unfamiliar with this, but my friend Dave Freer, who's South African, when he read the book, he started it right away. He knew what I was talking about. I basically used the combination of the formation of the countries of what's now called Lesotho and one of the great migrations at the time as sort of the model for the plot. So, yeah, it's got a lot of action in it. It's not slow-paced at all, but the underlying theme of it is how I think people need to look at human history. Do you look at it as being tragic? Do you look at it as being just, you know, an endless litany of stupidity and blunders? Or do you view it as basically quite heroic in its own way? And that is my view of it. I have a basically quite positive attitude toward human history and development of the human race, and that's what I tried to express in that novel. There's a lot of ways in which everything I've written since then is kind of a commentary on that first novel. The same themes you'll find popping up over and over again in most of it, right? But again, like I said, I try not to make it ponderous, and I think so far I've succeeded.
Yeah, I mean, it's a remarkable first novel. But before we get into the book itself, can you talk about how it came about? Tony Weisskopf told me she was the one who read it first as a submission.
Yeah.
You were a Writers of the Future winner just before.
Yes. Yeah, what happened was this. The first novel I wrote was a novel called Ford the Mage. And I took part of, not that novel, but the companion novel, The Philosophical Strangler, and I rewrote it as a short story, and that's what I submitted to the Writers of the Future contest, and I won first place in the winter quarter based on that story. The problem I had was that Ford the Mage was the novel I was actually trying to sell, but the problem I ran into was that it's kind of a weird book, I'm being honest about it. It's sort of comic fantasy, but it's patterned after the novels of the 17th and 18th century, not modern fantasy. So it's a lot of it's social satire. It's quirky. It is. There's no way around it. And the problem was that I really like the book, and I think it's a good book, but it's not an easy book to sell. I had an agent, and she liked the book herself, but she warned me that this was going to be a hard book to sell, and it proved to be. In fact, we never did sell it. We did eventually, but many years later. And after about 2 years of trying to sell it, I told my agent, just pull it off the market, because all we're doing is we're getting the kind of rejections that are sort of like, well, I really like it, but it's not suitable for our line, or, you know, or this is really more mainstream than fantasy, where we took it to mainstream publishers, and their reaction was, this is more fantasy, you know. So you don't want to rack up rejection letters like that, because once a publishing house rejects a novel, they're not going to look at it a second time, regardless of what the reason was. So instead, by then, I had written, I decided I'd write just a very much more straightforward science fiction novel that would be much easier to sell. And that's when I wrote Mother of Demons. That was in the fall of 1993. And I wrote it really at a very fast pace. I had it written in about 3 months. And we submitted that to several publishers, and eventually the one that bought it, and it took a while, but the one that bought it was Bain. And Tony was the first one who read it. It sat in Bain's lunchbox quite a while. Tony was then the chief editor. She read it early in 1996, and she liked it and recommended it to Jim Bain, and then, you know, I had to wait. It took him a few months to read it. But that's how it came about. Yeah. Eventually, I did sell Ford the Mage, but several years later, when Jim was by that point buying pretty much anything of mine.
We put that out. We put that out, right? Bain.
Bain published it. It actually wound up being the second novel in that series. I published the first one was called The Philosophical Strangler. Even though I'd written Ford the Mage first. But I decided that Strangler would be a better way to introduce people into the series. It really is pretty quirky. I really like it, but it has its fan base. But it's just not as much oriented to a popular audience as most of the things I write.
Tony told me that that she had recommended that you cut some stuff in Mother of Demons, and you pushed back against that, and she thought you were ultimately right. Do you remember that?
What happened was this. I don't remember that. What I do remember is that I thought the book was too short. But the reason was that my agent felt that for a first novel, I'd have a lot easier time selling it if I tried to keep it to 100,000 words. And the only way I could do that was I had to really, really pare down what I had intended to be a major subplot in the book. If you've read the book, so this will probably mean something to you, but the character of Nakuran, who figures very prominently in the novel, in the first draft didn't figure very much. She only figured at the very beginning, at the very end.
Yeah, she's one of the coolest parts of the book, though.
Yeah, no, I didn't like doing that, but my agent felt I kind of had to because, it's a first novel, et cetera, et cetera. Well, what then happened was that there was an aspect of the book Jim didn't like, which had to do with the mix of characters. And so he wanted me to expand the book for that reason. And that was fine with me because by doing that, I could expand, I could take care of what he wanted taken care of by mixing it up with expanding the current role back to the way I'd always originally envisioned it. So the first draft I submitted was 100,000 words, and the final draft that Bain published was 122,000 words. So I expanded quite a bit in the second draft. I don't remember any longer. It's been a long, long time. I don't remember. I have a memory Tony wanted something cut, but I don't honestly remember any longer exactly what it was. And so I just can't say much about that. I think
it was a bunch of philosophical stuff is what she said.
There's no question that putting that in was something of a gamble. I mean, it does make the book, and if you read, Amazon reviews of it, you'll see a certain number of readers crabbing about it. Come on, yak. What can get a little old is that the character of the central human character, Indira Toledo, does a lot of hand-wringing, and that can get a little old. As I remember right, Tony wanted to cut that back. I understood her point, but I actually think in the long run it's better that the novel came out the way it is. But, it's one of these judgment calls. Jim didn't seem particularly concerned about that side of it. So, you know, like I said, he actually didn't have a problem with expanding the novel quite a bit, which is what I really wanted to do. So it all worked out pretty well in the end.
Yeah. Well, when I you said it was 100,000, and I was like, that book is longer than that, because I just plowed through it on my Kindle, and it was a...
The final draft's quite a bit longer than that. But when I originally wrote it, that's how long it was. It was 100,000 words. And, I think it works much better at the length in which it is. Part of what happens is that... See, I think what... If you try to visualize the philosophical ponderings in that book without the character of Nakura is kind of a foil in a different kind of way than the human character is. So if you try to picture what the book would look like, see, in the first draft that I submitted to May, Nakura only appears in the very beginning, and then she disappears from the entire book and only comes back in again at the very end. It's really when you see everything through her eyes, because she's an outcast from alien society, that you get a different perspective on the kind of issues and problems that the human character Indira Toledo is wrestling with. Because the truth of the matter is, she's an academic. She's led a sheltered life, is the simple truth of it, until the shipwreck. And whereas Nakura comes from the lowest helot class of that alien society, and then just because of her military prowess becomes a famous soldier, warrior. But she really sees the underbelly of it. So from her point of view, she doesn't have a problem with the hard-edged decisions that Toledo winds up having to make by the end of the book. And if you take that out of the book, or if you don't have it there in the first place, I think it does unbalance the book, and I can see why Tony would have that reaction. I do think you'd have to do one of two things, either shorten the book or lengthen it. And what we wound up doing, which I think was a better way to do it, is lengthen it. But the original length was too constrained by just abstract considerations of space. As it turned out, Jim Bain never really cared that much about length of books. Some publishers care a lot more than he did. And he just didn't have a problem with expanding a first novel by what amounted to 25%.
Yeah. Well, speaking of Nakura, and she's kind of like this, the Achilles of giant snails, sentient snails. But you mentioned that she's considered a pervert or an outcast within her group because she's, what's wrong with a gukui, a sterile female and a true male?
One of the things I wanted to do with the novel, I have for a long time been dissatisfied with the way alien species are usually portrayed in science fiction. There are a few exceptions, but I just felt that way, way, way too often alien species were depicted one of two ways. Either what I'll call the Star Trek model, where they're basically just people with funny ears and funny foreheads. But, you know, they're basically humanoid, they're bipedal, all the rest of it. Or the other trope that a lot of authors use is a kind of biological determinism, where they'll model an alien species after a certain kind of terrestrial animal, and then they impart their culture is based on the ethnology and the behavior of that type of animal on Earth. So, for instance, you've had several authors who've used aliens that are sort of cat-like, and their culture tends to be cat-like in terms of dominance patterns and this, that, and the other thing. Or you have elephants are used, or, you know, whatever. And I think you wind up with, number one, a really simplistic kind of animal behavioralism, which doesn't even apply in the animal world and makes really very little sense as the basis for a intelligent species. There are reasons that it's hard to imagine any intelligent species getting very far if they don't develop a very complex and sophisticated culture. You know, if they stick to rigid animal behavior patterns, it's really hard to imagine them getting very far. Part of what I want to do with the novel is develop a really interesting and quite different alien species The trick to that, though, is you can't make them so alien that, because your readers are going to be human beings. And so they have to have enough resonance with human beings that your audience can read it and empathize and identify enough with the aliens that they can get into the story. So what I wound up doing was combining a couple things. I had for many years been fascinated by cephalopods. They are by far the most advanced and complex invertebrate on the planet Earth. They're very intelligent. They're fairly fascinating creatures, especially when you consider they're mollusks and they're related to things like clams and oysters. And in particular, I'm fascinated by their chromatophoric abilities, which is that octopuses and squids change color in response to different things in their environment and in different, in terms of different emotional reactions. So I thought it'd be fascinating to develop an intelligent alien species which were chromatophoric, where unlike human beings, where you can't really tell what someone's thinking or feeling by the way they look. I mean, to some, maybe some degree, somebody's flushing or looks angry, but not like these creatures where they literally, their whole bodies change color. And the second thing was I wanted to develop a very different sexual pattern that would be the underlying framework on which you develop quite a different culture in terms of what you can call marital relations, which are always central to any culture. And what I did there was I loosely modeled the alien sexual pattern on the sexual patterns of social insects, so that you wind up with most of the aliens, just as is true with bees or termites, are sterile workers or fighters, and they're female. And then there's only a very small percentage of females who are much larger who actually breed. And then there's a small number of males who are much smaller. And that's the pattern you have with social insects. But the thing that I found interesting there was that we are talking about intelligent species. They're not animals, and they're certainly not animals on a level of termites. And so thinking about it, I realized that it's hard to imagine that they would not develop sexual relations just basically for the fun of it, nothing else. And what you'd have, therefore, is a sexual pattern that in human terms would be predominantly lesbian. Now, I say in human terms because the terms are really kind of meaningless applied. It's a completely different alien species, and so the kind of issues of sexual orientation that apply to humans are really just inapplicable. But if you're going to use an analog, that's what it is. It's basically most of the aliens are female. They're not sterile. I mean, they're not fertile, and they have sexual relations with each other.
That is the norm.
And then you have a different sexual relation where the much larger females who are able to breed, who are called mothers, they do have sexual relations with males, but that's considered only a normal pattern for them, not for most aliens. And in this instance, I had a female, a sterile female, she's a warrior, who develops a romantic relationship with a male, which is considered in that society perverted. So in their terms, she and her boyfriend, are, so to speak, perverts, even though in human terms they would be considered the norm. So I did that partly just to switch things around because I thought it would make it interesting, and I wanted a character who is an outcast in that society, and this is an easy way of doing it.
Yeah, and you develop a great relationship between her and her much, much smaller male lover, Dawifa, I believe is his name.
Dawifa, yeah. Actually, the relationship I enjoyed the most was that I have a very young mother named Guo, who is one of the heroines of the book, and she winds up getting hooked up early on. Fertile females, mothers, don't mate with one single male. They mate with a male bond, a group of males. And so I develop actually a romantic relationship between her and these six young males, and they're all very young in alien terms, they're equivalent teenagers. So it was kind of a challenge to develop a romance between alien teenagers that's completely different. I mean, they're squids, basically. And I think it works. But I think readers get into it. But that was kind of fun. It's different. That's part of the reason I did it, is because it made me scratch, you know, in terms of figuring out how it all shake down and how. You always have to remember that when you introduce intelligence into the mix, all intelligent creatures are animals on one level, but you introduce intelligence in the mix, and it really changes everything. I mean, you're not going to get any kind of simple animal-like reactions. You're just not.
How did culture come about on this world? The world's called Ishtar. There's two different species, too, that are intelligent.
Yes, there are two species that are closely related. The Gukai, who are the dominant species, and then there's another species called the Owok, who are larger. They're related. They're very closely related. But the Owok are larger, but they're more primitive. And they're honestly just simply not as smart, as bright as the. They're intelligent, but they're, you know, the level of intelligence is more like what you'd expect from Homo habilis or maybe Australopithecines than from Homo erectus. Where I got that idea from was actually an essay by Stephen Jay Gould. The title of which, if I remember right, is that human equality is a contingent fact of history, and what he talks about in the essay is he said it is simply a fact that's contingent on the history of how the human species developed. It's just simply a fact that human beings all belong to one species, and therefore the level of advancement and intelligence of the entire species is essentially the same across the board. But he said that did not have to have developed that way. It could have happened that we would have wound up with two intelligent species for a while on the planet, which actually did happen for a while when you had Homo sapiens and Homo neanderthalus coexisting for tens of thousands of years. And then eventually Homo neanderthalus vanished. They used to think they just were driven to extinction. Now, based on genetic evidence, it's clear that there was a certain amount of interbreeding between Homo sapiens and Homo neanderthalus. But the point is, you could have had a situation where you had actually two different species that might have been able to interbreed, but they're still two different species, one of which was clearly superior to the other. It wasn't quite there. You know, the issue of equality, therefore, poses, or how you handle relations between those two species poses a trickier, more complex moral and philosophical issue than you face in our world, where the whole human race is one species, and so although there's been an enormous amount of bigotry and intolerance and prejudice and along racial lines throughout human history, on one basic level, you can just say that's all bullshit. Pardon my French. And solving that issue in moral terms has been very easy. In theory, of course, it's a lot harder to do in practice, but, you know, that you can just simply say all human beings are equal, that's the way it is, and, well, that's it. But what if that weren't true? What if you did have a species that was a separate species? It was also intelligent. They weren't animals, but they either weren't as intelligent or their intelligence didn't manifest itself in ways that enabled them to be good at military act, you know, things like that.
You'd have
added that into the mix also.
You'd have a ready-made slave caste, it seems to me.
Yeah.
If somebody wanted to go enslaving people.
Yeah, and then I also added a further complication because it turns out that the problem the humans face is that they cannot digest the food on that planet. And it looks like they're all going to starve to death. But it turns out, this is a little bit gross, but this is a pattern used by some animals. There are actually quite a number of animals where the offspring, the very young animals, basically eat the food that's been eaten and regurgitated by their parents because that breaks it down. The digestive cycle. And it turns out human beings can survive if they eat food that's been regurgitated by this other more primitive layer of or group of aliens called the Owok, which means that humans are completely dependent on the Owok, which means that the Owok thereby have suddenly gained very ferocious group of champions because they may not be able to defend themselves very well, but human beings really can. And then part of the ingredient in the story, which I thought would be, usually whenever you have aliens and humans mixing in stories, and especially movies, but even in novels, it tends to be the aliens who are the scary critters and humans who are not. And what I did in Mother Demons is I switch it around, and the title comes from the fact that from the alien point of view, these humans are really kind of demons. They move much faster than the aliens do, to the point where it's even hard sometimes for them to be able to follow what they're doing. And they're really scary and very dangerous. So that's where the title Mother of Demons comes from. But anyway, it was another interesting little twist. I try to put in as many twists and turns in that story as I could figure out, so that it would read. I didn't want it to read, you know, this is going to be my first novel. I've all worked out well, and I didn't want it to read, you know, just generic by the numbers.
Yeah.
Kind of writing, which I think it doesn't.
I agree completely, and we're putting it out in a leather-bound edition instead of forgetting that it exists. I think it was pretty successful.
Yeah, no, I'm quite happy with the book, even to this day.
Yeah. So tell us about the humans. They crash-landed, they arrive with a knowledge base, but they don't really have the tech still. Is there any way to preserve modern culture if you absolutely have no technological or trading base to start with, if it's robbed from you, but you have the knowledge?
They don't. Yeah, I believe you can. And I believe they do. What you have to do is the same process that I had my heroes in the 1632 series doing, only it's much more extreme in Mother Demons, in this process I call gearing down. You have the knowledge, but you can't recreate the tech base you started from. You don't begin to have the pyramid of tools to make tools to make tools to make tools. But you do still have the knowledge. And one of the things that I think people tend to drastically underestimate is the incredible resilience of modern industrial societies. I periodically get in arguments with people who talk about how this or that is going to cause a catastrophe, and, you know, it could be all kinds of things, the collapse of the electrical grid, asteroid strikes, whatever, and, you know, we'll all be doomed. And, you know, and what I always say to them is, can please explain to me how the devastation would be any worse than what Europe looked like at the end of World War II. I mean, all of Central Europe was bombed flat, literally bombed flat. Most of Europe was basically just a vast, barren wasteland. And half a century later, it had sprung back. The population, actually, at the end of World War II was larger than it was at the beginning of World War II, even in the areas most hit by the devastation. The thing about advanced industrial societies is they're really, really resilient, and that's because of that knowledge base, which primitive societies don't have. They simply don't have. So if they get hammered down flat by some kind of catastrophe, pulling themselves out is a really difficult, difficult process. But if you retain that information network, you've got an enormous leg up. Now, it's much harder in the Mother Demon universe than the 1632 universe. You only got a handful of adults instead of a whole town. They don't have laptops. You know, I mean, they don't have any of that. for one thing, I wrote the book before computers had really, I mean, they existed, but they weren't the kind of omnipresent feature of life they are today. So the information base tends to be retained inside people's heads more than it is recorded anywhere, but it's still there. And I think it makes a huge difference, too.
Well, also with this knowledge base comes knowledge of history. And our main human character, Indira, she was a historian. How does she propose, or can she not replicate the Mongol horde, or Sparta, or, you know, the litany of, you know, Dachau, the litany of horrible things that humans have done to win, or tried to do to win and then lost. This is her great fear, right?
Yeah, that's her great fear. It's what paralyzed her for, you know, most of the novel. Or, what she finally, the epiphany she finally has at the great battle at the end of the book, and it's largely the character Nakuran who, her actions that bring her to it, is that you can't separate the misery of human history with its advancement, because they're just part of the same process. In other words, there's no an advanced, ethically sound, you know, democratic, egalitarian society does not and cannot emerge, you know, like Athena from the brow of Zeus. It's not how it happens. It has to happen through a long process of struggle. It's the actual struggle that makes it real and gives it its strength and its vitality and its resilience. And so that everything she fears is also necessary part of the whole process that would eventually produce the kind of civilization she'd like to see. She can't, you know, you can't have your cake and eat it too, or as I think she at one point realizes, there's no royal road to where she wants to go. You know, there's ways you can hopefully minimize the amount of misery and bloodshed and so forth, but basically you're still going to have to get your hands dirty and get your feet in the mud. There's no way around it. And that's just part and parcel of the process. That's how a whole species learns and internalizes the culture and the values they begin to develop, is through that process of struggle. There's simply no other way to do it, and at least no other way the human race has ever found to do it.
Yeah.
And that's a kind of somewhat stark, but that's a heroic view of human history, which is the one I have, personally. And that's what she finally realizes at the end of the book. And based on that, she's able to start doing a number of things in terms of proposing, you know, new military tactics, a new type of way to organize politically, you know, so on and so forth. And that's where the book ends.
There's, you mentioned before, there's a religion it's the birth of a larger a non-God-based or animistic religion. And there's even a St. Paul-like figure in the book who is Ushulabang. And are the tenets of Golaku, this Buddha, it's kind of Taoism too, or Taoism. Anything, is that your religion, or is it just made-up book stuff?
Yeah, no, I actually designed it. There's nothing really quite like it, because I designed it based on the principles of dialectical logic rather than formal logic, which no religion I know of has ever done. And what I mean by that is that it has no answers. It simply keeps posing questions, which is one of the central tenets of the founder of that religion. There is no answer. There are only the questions. It makes it very open-minded, very dynamic. As far as the ethos of it is concerned, it's more akin to something like Buddhism or Taoism or Confucian, you know, the Far Eastern religions, than it is the Judeo-Christian traditions, because there is no deity as such. There's no God figure. The religion doesn't really concern itself very much with big questions of cosmology and cosmogony the way the Western religious tradition does, which is, in fact, true of Buddhism and Taoism and Confucianism. They don't really spend a lot of time contemplating or figuring out, you know, where's the universe come from, who created it, so on and so forth. It's just not what they're concerned with. They're concerned with basically behavior and how you should act and codes of conduct.
Well, there's an analog to, I mean, Golaku, your original, he both seemed like a sort of drunken monk, but he also had a lot of Christ-like qualities, because, you know, I mean, Jesus didn't care.
Yeah, he did. Yeah, he does. I mean, I'm cribbing from a lot of things. Yes, he does. And there's a constant tendency after her death to have her be created into a godlike figure, and her disciple, Ushulabang, keeps fighting against it. There's a scene in the book where the humans come across a great big statue of what they later find was Guaco, and then Ushulabong, when she comes across, she destroys the statue because she considers it ridiculous. So there's no direct human analog to that religion now. It's kind of a, to some degree, it's patterned after Buddhism, but the central philosophical tenets are not Buddhist at all. They're more ethereal, they're more abstract. They're based on more of just purely logical ways of looking at the world and dealing with things. It's there, and I limb some basic elements of it, but the reader gets more of an impression than any. I mean, I'm not trying to lay out all the various tenets and so forth, because I'm writing a novel.
Yeah, there's so many cool little philosophical seeds in Mother of Demons, as well as some great discussion of battle tactics and human history. So the book is Mother of Demons, special leather-bound edition by Eric Flint. It's now at booksellers. These will go fast, so get it while you can. Eric, thanks so much for being with us today and talking about Mother of Demons.
Sure. I enjoyed it.
And now here is another entry in the complete audiobook serialization of Larry Correa's Hard Magic, as read by Bronson Pinchot. This portion of Hard Magic is provided by Audible.com. Get the complete audiobook at Audible.com now. If you're not a subscriber, you can get the entire audiobook free or choose from more than 100,000 other titles when you try Audible free for 30 days. Here's the setup for what's coming up. It's the 1930s in America, but it's an America that has been magically changed. In the 1860s, a handful of people from all walks of life were visited with special magical talents, and each generation more are so affected. These people are called actives. Most actives use their powers for good, but some don't. Jake Sullivan is a private eye. He's also a former soldier, an ex-con, and an active heavy, the type of active that controls the force of gravity. Jake is good at it. Jake has been recruited by a mysterious secret organization of actives, the Grimnoir, who are dedicated to seeing humanity through a possible magic-based apocalypse, an apocalypse that seems to be accelerating toward a terrible finale. Here is Bronson Pinchot with this portion of the complete audiobook serialization of Larry Correa's Hard Magic.
As the storm clouds parted, they spotted the Tokugawa before it spotted them, which was easy to do since it was the size of a skyscraper flipped on its side and was running with all of its lights blazing. It was 1,000 feet lower than they were, but only a mile ahead. "Will you look at that?" Lance whistled. "It's huge."
"Forget that," Faye said. "There's 2 of them."
Francis followed her pointing finger. Sure enough, there was another vessel ahead of the triangular Tokugawa. Once again, her weird gray eyes proved superior to everyone else's. This craft was also wedge-shaped, but more bulbous. It was only running a few lights, so its overall size was hard to determine, but it had to be at least as big as the flagship.
"What is that thing?"
Mr. Chandler, the accountant, had joined them in the control center. "I believe that is a Kaga-class super dreadnought."
"How do you know that?"
"Because UBF made a fortune selling the design to the Imperium," the accountant replied. "That's one of ours. I'm afraid your grandfather didn't really worry about the embargo."
"Weapons?"
Lance asked hesitantly. "Unknown. We just provided the basic hull, and they worked out the rest, but probably at least equivalent to a Great War battleship, and it has a hold that can fit, depending on the size, a whole bunch of planes." Lance scratched his beard.
"Define bunch, Mr. Chandler."
40 or 50.
"That nice pirate captain has 2, Faye pointed out. "Now, I'm not an expert or nothing, but that doesn't seem quite fair."
Francis bit his lip. If it had still just been a rescue mission, he would have called it off.
It didn't make sense to trade a bunch of lives for one, even though they'd probably have to knock Dan out first and tie him down, but this was too big now. The Geotel was on that thing. Call the Marauder. Warn them and get their ETA. The battleship won't be able to shoot at us if we're tethered to the Tokugawa. Lance looked at him slyly. You're sounding more like a captain already, kid. You want the hat back? Not after it's been on your smelly head. FS Bulldog Marauder. Captain Southunder put the mirror down. The news had been grim. In 20 minutes, they'd break the edge of the storm. Sullivan held on to the wall of the stateroom as the dirigible was slammed back and forth by the wind. The creaking and flapping was making him nervous. It would really not be fair if they crashed before they even had the chance to get shot down. Two ships, which also means that the crew of the flagship will be reinforced with more men, Southunder said slowly. Not to mention Maddie, who was probably capable of killing all of them by himself, but he didn't bring that up. Dealing with his brother was personal business. What are you going to tell your crew? Sullivan asked. They were pirates, after all, and mutiny was a distinct possibility. Southunder smiled. Why, the truth, of course. He stood and walked from the room, not seeming to notice that the entire place was swaying violently back and forth and rattling like they were about to fly apart at any second. Remember how I was talking about loyalty? Let's see if I was right, because I've already been wrong far too much for one day.
I hope you ain't on a roll, Sullivan muttered as he followed.
Most of the Marauder's crew had assembled in the little galley. They were a motley bunch of toughs, armed to the teeth, outside the law, perfectly adjusted to killing, and they were about to be asked to go on a deadly mission to help a bunch of folks who not only didn't care about them, but didn't even know they existed. Southunder stopped at the front of the room. Sullivan was expecting some big display, maybe a pep talk, like the kind General Roosevelt had given them before Second Sum. Fat lot of good that had done. Instead, Southunder sat on the end of a table and folded his arms. He didn't even raise his voice. Well, boys, I've got bad news. We've got two Imperium ships. Both of them are bigger and have more guns than we do, with probably 10 times the crew. There's probably going to be several iron guards on board, not to mention ninjas, and who knows what other kinds of terrible blood magic.
What's the bad news? Barnes asked jokingly.
One of the ships is a Kaga, which means that it is ringed in 37-millimeter long-range cannons, and a main 10-inch gun. Rumor is that they might even have a peace ray. If that don't get us, the host of biplanes piloted by fanatics probably will. I won't lie. Our odds of survival are about none. He was completely honest.
So we're running? A muscular Polynesian with tattoos all over his face asked.
No, Mr. Payanga, we're not. Because aboard one of those ships is a super weapon that is about to destroy a quarter of the United States. And once it falls, then the rest of the world will surrender. The chairman will rule the world, and everyone like us will be extinct within a year, tops. This job isn't about the loot, crew. I'm asking you to do this because it's the right thing to do. Stick with me, and I'll do everything I can to make sure we make it through.
This is madness, said the badly scarred Ken.
I'd take volunteers, but we're either all in or all out. There's no time to drop anyone off. We either fight together or we run. And if we run, you'll have to kill me first. I can't promise we'll live, but we'll die free men, and our great-grandkids will tell stories about the bravery that goes on tonight.
There was a tiny voice from the back of the room.
I... not have babies yet? Like to have babies someday?
Lady Origami squeezed between the burly men. She had neatly folded a piece of rice paper into an intricate shape. She tossed it into the air, and the miniature blimp almost seemed like it would fly, but it burst into magical flame and was consumed instantly.
But only babies I make be from Imperium Rapers if Chairman win, I fight with captain.
I didn't join to prove I'm brave. I joined to make money, Parker said, but then he smiled. And to kill some Imperium. I'm in. One by one, the pirates added their assent. The last to speak was the young American, Barnes.
Do I get to take a raptor out and die in a glorious dogfight?
Yes, Southunder answered. Barnes grinned.
I wouldn't miss it.
Southunder nodded calmly. Let's go murder some Imperium dogs then. Every last one.
Every last one! All the pirates shouted together.
Sullivan followed Southunder back into the hall, figuring he could learn a thing or two about leadership from this man.
You didn't tell them that the chairman himself would be on board.
Southunder gave him a sad little smile. They're brave, Sullivan. Not suicidal.
That was another segment in our complete audiobook serialization of Larry Correia's Hard Magic. It's read by Bronson Pinchot. And that's it for the podcast. Thanks to Audible.com, to Amanda Holton for editing Snips and Slices, and to podcast theme composer Ruth Judkowitz. And the triumphant cry of approval from the entire population of planet Earth's mollusks for an author finally seeing their true potential, and free passage to Dialectic Paradise when next the Kraken rises to Eric Flint, author of Mother of Demons, now in beautiful signed, leather-bound edition at booksellers everywhere. Please join us next time here at the hammering heart of science fiction and fantasy. And keep reaching for the stars.